Hi, I'm Michael Sparra. I'm the chair of the Department of Health Policy and Management at the Mailman School of Public Health at Columbia University. And I want to welcome you to the inaugural event in the HPM 2021 book series, in which Professor Mark Bittman will talk about his new book just out yesterday, right off the press, called Animal Vegetable Junk, A History of Food from Sustainable to Suicidal. In a minute, I'm going to introduce Mark along with one of our students who will be talking with Mark later in the hour about the book. But first, a brief overview of our agenda for the event. Mark will start us off talking for about 10, 15 minutes or so on why he took on this book project, key questions he hoped to answer, and key conclusions he reached. We'll then open it up to questions, starting first by having Christina Abraham, a student of ours, you know, pick out from a subset of questions we received in advance from folks during the event registration process, but then adding questions that come in during the event on the Q&A as you're listening to Mark. And I have to say, Mark is really enthused about answering as many questions as possible. So start posting them on that Q&A feature as soon as you have them. We'll plan to finish the Q&A process at around 4:55 or so, a few minutes before the end of the hour, at which point Becca Schoenfeld, who organizes and administers all our HPM events, including this one, will join us. And Becca will conduct a raffle in which two lucky participants will get signed copies of the book from Mark himself. So be sure to hang around for the raffle, which should be a lot of fun. And finally, just one more thing before I do introductions, a quick note that we'll have our next event in this book series on March 3rd at 4 o'clock, in which Professor Meg Fitzgerald will discuss her recently published book entitled Ascending Davos, A Career Journey from the Emergency Room to the Boardroom. Okay, a couple of quick introductions. Christina Abraham is a second year MPH student here in Health Policy and Management in our department, who's now interning with the Mayor's Office of Economic Opportunity here in New York City while she completes her degree requirements. We're really grateful to Christina that she's agreed to engage with Mark and asks him the questions that we receive from you, the audience. And Mark, many of you know Mark from his 30 plus cookbooks, including the How to Cook Everything series. Others of you know Mark from his work as a food journalist and as a columnist, especially from his many years writing for the New York Times. Many of you know Mark as a true food policy expert who teaches a class here in HPM, teaching it right now, this semester here in the school, on the food justice movement. What does it mean for public health? But most of all, Mark is a truly important voice in the current and ongoing debate over how we got the food system that we have and how we can do better. And he's written a book now that describes the origin and the evolution of food, the more recent domination of food systems by big agriculture and by big junk. He writes in the introduction to his book that, quote, to meet the human and environmental crises head on, we must ask ourselves, what would a just food system look like? Mark is a colleague and he's a friend. We're lucky to have him in the department and we're grateful that he's agreed, and in the school, and we're grateful that he's agreed to talk with us today about his new book and about what it would take to get us to a just food system. Mark, the floor, the Zoom floor is all yours. Thank you.
The virtual floor. Thank you, Michael. Welcome, everyone. Thank you to Christina. As Michael said, I'm going to talk for a few minutes and then we'll engage in a conversation based on your questions. So here we go. Even in the era of COVID, the world's leading cause of premature death is chronic disease. And the leading cause of chronic disease is diet. We've largely conquered infectious disease, which is one of the reasons COVID has become, was such a shock to us. But COVID will be conquered while diet-related chronic disease remains largely ignored. As is food in general, not ignored in the sense that we don't think about it, almost everyone is always thinking about it, but ignored in the sense that we don't value it properly. And that's why I wrote Animal Vegetable Junk, in the hope that people will see how critical it is for us to do so, and the costs of not doing so. Some of us, of course, and public health people in particular, recognize that nutrition and malnutrition are pieces of a much bigger puzzle. Putting this all together is a very long conversation, and that's what my book is about. But to start this session off, I'll give a super abbreviated version of the story. And then, as I said, we'll get into a conversation based on your questions. Malnutrition once resulted almost exclusively from an unvaried diet, one that focused on too few foods and even too few calories. Now there's another kind of malnutrition, the eating of too many calories, often of the least nutritious or even what we might call anti-nutritious kind. As you all know, I'm talking about what's most easily labeled junk food, the ultra-processed food that was literally invented in the 20th century. Both of these patterns of malnutrition, too few calories and too many of the wrong ones, affect billions of humans, perhaps a third alive today. But it's the second kind, the overeating of anti-nutritious food, that has stimulated the growth of chronic disease, which in turn makes people less resistant to opportunistic infections like COVID-19. And those dietary syndromes are on the rise globally. Furthermore, the solutions are not as simple as a vaccine. They'll take far more work and time and way more dramatic solutions. Yet it's going to all be worth it. If we make the necessary changes, we'll be living in a much improved world. Because the factors that make the diet-related disease pandemic ongoing and more threatening than the one associated with COVID are underlying and conjoining, and their connections are increasingly clear. Chronic illness led by diabetes, heart disease, and various cancers are simply the most obvious results of the new form of malnutrition. And contrary to what industry and most governments would have you believe, developing these kinds of ailments is not simply a matter of personal choice. When 60% or so of the food sold doesn't support adequate nutrition, it follows that 60% of the calories people consume aren't meeting their nutritional needs. But the impact of producing, processing, and peddling non-nutritious food is even greater than that, because diet-related disease is far from the only problem associated with our food system. Let's begin with the fact that food comes from soil, sun, and water, and that the first of these, and that the care of the first of these, soil, is or should be the primary goal of agriculture. Let's understand this. Soil is like a pantry that must be replenished. Without replenishment, it can't provide. And the history of industrial agriculture is the ongoing attempt to extract as much from the soil as possible while replenishing it inadequately and often not at all. This hasn't worked out so well. Replenishment means putting back as much as you take out. Any nutrient that's left after humans or other animals eat or build or burn, all food waste and human, plant and animal waste, all detritus from the fields and forests, all of this must be returned to the soil. Failing to do that will inevitably and always result in declining quality of crops, declining quality and even quantity of food, and declining nutrition. We've seen where that leads many times. We're seeing it now. The new form of malnutrition can be traced to a lack of respect for land and the people who work it. Thousands of years ago, when almost all humans lived close to the soil and understood our dependency on it, those who practiced the best management were rewarded with stable crops and thriving civilizations. Those who ignored good soil management saw diminished harvests, failed crops, hunger, forced migration, and even societal collapse. Soil degradation may not have directly destroyed those civilizations, but it left them vulnerable to the forces that did destroy them. Let's fast forward to the modern era, let's say the 15th century. After the plague ravaged Europe, more land was sought by growing populations, which were increasing trade, developing new dependence on finance, and acting on the idea that crops could be bought and sold regardless of the needs of nearby eaters. This was especially true in Europe, whose people were more dependent than others on animal products. Raising animals for food takes more land than raising plants for food. And this eventually, but quite directly, led to searching for more pasture, and in turn to colonialism, land theft, genocide, and slavery. By the 18th century, so much land was invaded, stolen, occupied, and farmed that populations were growing faster than ever. There were even theorists who said that humans would outstrip the ability of soil to produce enough food for everyone. Indeed, soil was being forced to overproduce without adequate replenishment. Even more important, though, was that the crops soil were used for were being grown for trade and profit rather than for human sustenance. In our imagination, in another dimension, when occupying the Western Hemisphere, thoughtful Europeans might have paused for a moment and asked, how can this land we've appropriated be used to support and benefit the world's people? To produce nutritious food that protects the land and provides good work for many. If that had happened, we'd be living in a different and much better world. Instead, the question that was asked was, how much money can the most aggressive individuals make from this land, regardless of the consequences? We've seen where that's gotten us. Eventually, it was discovered that certain additions to soil, especially those containing high levels of nitrogen, and even those imported from elsewhere, could go a long way to replenishing it. This led to the famous guano craze of the mid-19th century. Guano is the excrement of seabirds and bats. It's essentially ready-made organic fertilizer, containing not only high levels of nitrogen, but of potassium and phosphorus, two other key plant nutrients. The largest concentration of guano was found on islands off the west coast of Peru, although it was soon discovered elsewhere and shipped all over the world until, of course, its supply diminished beyond the point of profitability. It had taken maybe 50 years to use up the accumulation of eons. This was another tipping point. Without nitrogen from elsewhere, industrial farming was impossible. Old-style soil replenishment was too slow to reliably and profitably farm for cash. What had to happen, according to the would-be industrial agriculturalists, led by British and American theorists and capitalists, was that a way had to be found to extract nitrogen from the atmosphere. As you probably know, the air is mostly nitrogen, but that nitrogen isn't accessible to plants. But in the early 20th century, a German named Fritz Haber developed a way to remove nitrogen from the air and combine it with hydrogen to produce a form of ammonia that plants could use as food. Why did this have to happen? Why could humans not continue to farm through recycling, doing what we'd now call regenerative agriculture, indefinitely? If you had to answer that question in one word, that answer would be global trade for profit. Okay, that's four words, but the one word answer is capitalism. Capitalism birthed industrial agriculture as the need for profits meant that crops were grown not for their ability to feed people, but for their ability to generate cash. As I said, this isn't a short conversation, but their major points can be made briefly. I'm going to tick through the upshots of these developments, of the shift to what's most simply and quite accurately called factory farming. So quickly, and not necessarily in order, direct results of the growth of industrial agriculture include land theft. That's mostly been on the part of white European males, what we would call the global north, at the expense of indigenous people of the Western Hemisphere and of what we now call the global south. Slavery and associated institutionalized racism, as well as general exploitation of land workers. Cash crops generally are raised by large landholders who don't themselves work the land, but need lots of labor. All of this happened in an era where such a thing as a ruling class was acceptable. Since no longer is, ha ha, we're working to dismantle this. Next, more and more farming on increasingly large tracts of land, because growing one crop on huge acreage is the best way to farm for cash. And then there was the invention of machinery to ease that kind of farming. This isn't necessarily a bad thing, but it became a profitable business on its own with products that were usually too expensive to benefit small-scale farmers. Similarly, the development of hybrid seeds, again, not necessarily a bad thing, but often too expensive for small-scale farmers. Both machinery and hybrid seeds, of course, are geared mostly toward what we call monoculture, the farming of one crop on huge tracts of land. Then, of course, there was the invention of new chemicals, not only nitrogen-based fertilizer, which is an inadequate substitute for organic matter, but pesticides of all kinds, which poison not only their targets, but many of the planet's other species. And then the impact of these factors and others leading to the gradual and virtual elimination of small-scale farmers throughout much of the world, along with the ways of life that go with them, many of which are more communal, humane, and healthy than what's replaced them. We're still describing consequences of industrial agriculture. Then there was the development in the mid-20th century of an industrial system of raising animals, one that involves ongoing torture and death of tens of billions of unnaturally raised animals each year, using unreplenishable and unsustainable resources to produce nutritionally and morally inferior meat and dairy. That changed agriculture even further. You had to grow food for those animals, and that food was grown in ever more so-called efficient ways. It also deprived non-animal eaters of access to food. Another result were political famines, which began in the 19th century, first with the so-called Irish potato famine, and which continued into the 20th with the deliberate withholding of food from peasants by the governments of Britain, the USSR, China, and others, resulting in more deaths than the great 20th century wars. At the same time, food began to be used not as food, but as a component to make edible food-like substances. For example, corn was grown to be consumed not as corn, but as a major component of animal feed, junk food, and even gasoline in the form of ethanol. Eventually, we became aware that these processes were not so gradually poisoning our water, land, air, and people, hastening the climate crisis and leading to the outright extinction of millions of our fellow species. And we saw a quick decline in the nutritional quality of food, the things I talked about a few minutes ago, the global increase of chronic disease, even a shortening of the expected lifespan in affected countries, along with the further weakening of the immune systems of vulnerable populations, making them far more susceptible to the ravages of coronavirus and other infectious diseases. Finally, at least for now, and incredibly, there's become a general sense of confusion around food, including a lack of understanding of some of nature's simplest rules, such as how to eat. No other animal has ever asked the question, how should I eat? Humans now do that all the time because the obvious answers have been obscured by marketing and supply. There's more, but that brings us more or less to now, when almost everyone except those who profit from it acknowledges that the world of food is rife with formidable problems, the consequences of turning an essential source of nourishment, our key to life, into just another global profit center. You will hear, you've all heard, the food system is broken. But the truth is that it works well enough, almost perfectly, for big food. It also works well enough for around a third of the world's people for whom food simply appears to be eaten at will. But it doesn't work well enough to nourish most of humanity, and it doesn't work well enough to husband our resources so that it can endure. The system has not only created a public health crisis about which most people are aware, perhaps even more crucially, it's become a chief contributor to the climate crisis, our great existential threat. The way we produce food endangers everyone, even the wealthiest, but the harmful results of industrial agriculture disproportionately affect people without money. This means these so-called food issues are actually issues of class, of race, of gender, of fairness. It may be too much to say that food production, processing, and distribution are the drivers of inequality, but they are key. How then do we move forward? We start by promoting farming that integrates ecological principles into agriculture, that marries soil replenishing traditions with a better understanding of the powers of regeneration. As a scientific approach to farming that considers nature's power and her gifts, rather than seeing her as something to be conquered, this kind of farming, now often called agroecology, stands in opposition to industrial agriculture. Agroecology is supported by La Via Campesina, the international peasant movement, as well as by the United Nations and governments as different as those of France, Cuba, and India. Agroecology recognizes that how we grow and process and distribute food affects everyone and everything on Earth, and that only by doing this fairly can we expect to thrive as a society and as one of millions of Earth species. It acknowledges that growing food well is more than a series of techniques, but a philosophy, a commitment to improve society, a multicultural political movement for global social justice. Farmers worldwide are struggling to maintain or regain control of their food supply while rejecting the global norms of development that mandate urbanization, industrialization, so-called efficiency, and large scale. The alternative is food sovereignty, land for those who want to farm it, and farmers who control what they produce while making a living and stewarding the land. Agriculture and eating are political acts. For everyone to eat well, we must grow well. For us to grow well, we must have equality and justice. It's important to see that big picture. That we need a more fair society is a common and routine statement. But to think about what it means scares people and may even lead to despair, nihilism, and hopelessness. You might say, that's never going to happen. Let's go drinking. But it's equally important to focus on the relatively small changes that we can make or begin to make in our own lives and communities. Changes in diets, changes in school lunches, changes in the so-called emergency food system, in junk food regulation, in the way we buy and prepare food, in our approach to and our support of local land reform and redistribution, in getting land into the hands of those who've been historically and unfairly denied it, in working for politicians who will enforce and improve existing clean water and air regulations, in legislating the reduction of pesticide use, in supporting those who practice regenerative farming techniques or who actively fight factory farming, in reducing the distance between growers and eaters by encouraging and supporting local farming, and much more. As it turns out, these are answers not only to the questions, how do we reduce diet-related disease, or how do we stop poisoning our soil, but they directly address the question, how do we build a just society? How we relate to land and the food we grow has everything to do with how we live on the earth and who benefits and who suffers from that treatment. Good agriculture means the empowerment of women and indigenous and generally exploited people. It means land reform. It means fair distribution of resources and treatment of labor, affordable good food, nutrition and diet, and animal welfare. To make food that's fair, green, affordable, and nutritious takes an equitable and just society. And you can't have one without the other. That is the end of my prepared remarks, and Christina is going to join us and moderate a question and answer session for the next 20 or 25 minutes. Hi, Christina.
Hi there, Professor. Thank you so much for providing that overview. I know I'm really excited to read the book. I'm definitely a fan of the Food is Medicine movement, and I think there's a lot to kind of unpack here. So, you know, like Dr. Sparrow mentioned, feel free for anyone who has questions, drop them in the Q&A. We have received many questions up front, so I'm going to go through those first, and then we'll just see how much we can get through. So up first, we have a question around the most effective stage for food activists. So in terms of pushing healthy, sustainable legislation, do you view the best combination at the federal level, the state level, or perhaps a combo of both?
I mean, combo is the right word here. For the Trump years, of course, I would argue that local activism was the best. But in just 2 weeks, we've seen great progress on the federal level, and we may see more. Two examples of that are that included in the non-compromise Democratic version of the pandemic relief bill is the $15 minimum wage across the board. That's been inserted into that bill, and as far as I know, is being supported by 49 out of 50 Democratic senators, the exception being Senator Manchin from West Virginia. That's a developing situation, but the fact that the $15 minimum wage is included in federal legislation that has a good chance of passage is a really terrific thing. There's a bill being sponsored by Senators Booker, Gillibrand, and Warren that is the beginning of reparations for Black farmers it's a flawed bill, I will say that right up front, but it's the first time that we've seen civil rights and land reform on the same page. And that's a bill that can be supported. So federal legislation is coming into play, but local activism is still probably the most effective way because we can have quick impact on our local communities and because each of us can make a difference sooner. But they're of course not mutually exclusive. And I think it's important and worthwhile to engage in both, as it is worthwhile and important to engage in personal changes. So change in food has the unusual ability to run the gamut from how you treat yourself to how you treat the planet. And we can have impact on those two things and everything in between.
Yeah, absolutely. And I wonder if you kind of think from a legislative or policy perspective, or even a personal dietary change perspective, if you think that Monsanto, which is, you know, a controversial topic in this space, if you have any thoughts on how to kind of tackle their role in the industry.
Well, Monsanto was bought by Bayer a couple of years ago, as many people know, for some tens of billions of dollars. And one has to wonder whether Bayer sees this as a mistake, since Monsanto is on the losing end of a number of court cases, mostly based on injuries to farmers for the use of glyphosate, which is the key ingredient in Roundup, which is Monsanto's, has been Monsanto's primary profit. Profit-making product. I don't think, no, let me think for a second. Consumers can have a direct impact on how well Monsanto does or how not well it does by not buying foods with GMOs or by buying organic foods, of course. And I think that's important. I think a bigger struggle, in a way, a more important one, is one that says, let's clean up the environment. Let's restrict pesticides that are harmful in general. Let's look at reduced pesticide use as a way to do better farming, a way to protect human health and environmental health. We subsidize industrial agriculture to the tune of many tens of billions of dollars every year. And yet industrial agriculture is not held accountable for the damage that it does to our environment, not only to its greenhouse gas generation, which is significant, profound even, but to the overall damage to the land, air, and water that's done by pesticides, that's done by industrial waste from factory farms. And I think, many people think, that if we're going to be subsidizing agriculture, we have the right to demand that we subsidize a cleaner, better form of agriculture, one that uses fewer chemicals in general and fewer pesticides in particular. As I said during my little talk, pesticides are agents of death. Maybe I didn't say that specifically, but pesticides are chemicals whose job it is to kill animals or plants that are unwanted, but they're not so well targeted that they only kill some. There's always collateral damage. Part of that collateral damage is the earth in general. It's the water supply. It's not a coincidence that the city of Des Moines has the most expensive water treatment plant on earth, and it's air. So I think that the question of how we deal with Monsanto is a bigger question. And the question is really, how do we deal with chemicals in farming?
Yeah, I think there's kind of a lot to think about there. There are some questions coming in about New York City's composting program. So it was
dropped. Bit of a jump there.
yeah, I thought I would just try to get as many of these questions as possible. So the question coming in is, you know, that this is a very, composting is a very important aspect of good soil and climate change, and it doesn't seem like there's a priority on these programs as the program was dropped in New York City. And do you have any advice on that, kind of pushing those programs forward?
Well, again, that's a question. I think that New York has been, I don't mind saying that the de Blasio administration has been disappointing from the perspective of food, and I don't think has pushed the urban food movement or joined with the urban food movement as much as it might have. Urban farming, composting, et cetera, in general, is not so much about producing better food or producing significant amounts of food in cities, although there's nothing, that's not to be denied that it can be a part of food raising, but it's about education, it's about empowering people, It's about showing people what it takes to produce good food and what a good food system means. And it's about, again, empowering people to do that. So composting is a part of that, but the urban agriculture movement in general is a bigger part of that. And it would be good to have a city administration that supported that and that believed that.
Yeah, and I think some folks on this webinar today are definitely looking at the new administration in Washington in terms of their support for some of these programs. A question's just come in around Tom Vilsack. If he's confirmed as the USDA secretary, do you have concerns? Do you have thoughts? Are you hopeful about this?
Tom Vilsack was a lousy Secretary of Agriculture during the Obama administration. He's promising to be better. He was about as disappointing a choice as Joe Biden could have made among the possible candidates for Secretary of Agriculture. But I believe he's susceptible to pressure. He may be better intentioned than he was. I think he should be pressured, he should be pushed, and perhaps he'll do the right thing this time around. But he was a beyond disappointing Secretary of Agriculture during the Obama administration, and we can only hope that he does better this time around.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of thoughts amongst the group, questions coming in about some of the new appointments and even the, you know, the different legislation in New York City. So shifting again a little bit, can you address what's occurring in the dairy industry in upstate New York? You know, many local dairy farmers are competing against corporate milk, not organic, and they're just not able to compete on price. Can you speak to this a little bit?
Yeah, price supports have largely gone to what you would call big dairy, I suppose. And there has been a lot of consolidation in the dairy industry. It's difficult for small farmers in general, not just dairy farmers, but small farmers in general, to play in a market that's dominated by big agriculture. And what has to happen is that we need to encourage the growing and development of good food and discourage the growing and development of less good food. What's happened now is that government is supporting industrial agriculture at the expense of small farmers everywhere. This isn't just dairy farmers in New York State. This is small farmers all over the country and indeed small farmers all over the world. So again, if we're going to subsidize agriculture, and I believe we should, we need to be subsidizing good agriculture. And that mostly begins with small farmers.
Agreed, definitely. And just to tie in some of these other questions, do you see, you know, small farmers, you know, in this particular case, we're talking about dairy farmers, but a lot of folks are kind of asking about plant-based diets, vegan diets, and I know you've done some writing on this and have your own dietary guidelines that you follow. In terms of both supporting farmers, from a, you know, individual consumer perspective, but also from a health perspective. Can you just talk a little bit about your thoughts on plant-based diets or, you know, how that fits into the overall picture of the industry and climate change?
You know, I just got off an interview where the guy said to me, it was a similar question. And the guy said to me, in my personal life, I try to avoid highly processed food. I try to avoid junk food, try to avoid sugar, and I try not to eat more animal products than I need to. And I said, there's nothing more to it than that. And that is the answer to that question. And the thing is that everybody knows it. So why isn't everybody doing it? Well, part of it is willpower, no question. But a lot of it is that the supply encourages us to eat ultra-processed food. The food supply, there's an estimate that says that 60% of the calories out in the market in the United States today are from ultra-processed food. Someone has to eat that 60% of calories. someone is eating that 60% of calories. This is not a demand question. This is a supply question. It's a question of what we grow, how we process. That's what's determining what we eat to a large extent.
Agreed. And do you think that organic food, you know, you're kind of talking about a harm reduction approach of kind of not, you know, cleaning up your diet as much as possible. And it's really just that simple. I mean, do you have feelings about folks kind of eating more organic food or not? I mean, it's obviously a price prohibitive for some communities.
The great benefit of organic food is that it doesn't allow pesticides or chemical pesticides in its growth, and that protects farm workers. That is the greatest benefit of organic food. It's important to remember that organic is a label that means a few things, and there's a legal definition at this point, but that in an era where we see commercials for things like Michelob organic hard seltzer, we have to remember that organic is not a magic formula any more than vegan is a magic formula. Junk food is junk food, whether it's organic or not. And that's the primary job of most eaters should be to avoid ultra processed food.
Yeah, that's, I think it's definitely key to remember that organic doesn't necessarily equal healthy. So this is sort of taking a global perspective, and I'm curious about this question as well. But do you have thoughts on the current protests in India by local farmers being threatened by, you know, kind of large scale agricultural reforms?
No, India is a nation of, I won't claim to be an expert on this. India is a nation of small farmers. I was there 3 years ago and saw encroaching huge farms everywhere that I traveled. And I traveled in agricultural regions primarily. Small farms are threatened. This is not a joke. Small farms are threatened by industrial agriculture, and industrial agriculture is spurred and subsidized by the global economic system. The problem, or one problem, is that when countries want to join the global economic system, they are forced to join the global agricultural system. This is what NAFTA was about. This is what the GATT, the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, is about. And this is what the food sovereignty movement is about. People need to determine how they grow their food and what they grow locally and regionally, rather than being dictated to by national and international governments and corporations. That's what those protests are about.
And do you think that there is, and this could be about India or just kind of, you know, legislators in the United States as well, but do you think there's something that policymakers most often get wrong when they're thinking through either subsidies or, you know, potential legislation, food policy? Is there something that you can pick on as kind of a theme?
It's not really a food question. It's a political question. And as long as we have an electoral college, as long as we have a Senate, as long as we allow unlimited lobbying, we're going to have these kinds of problems. I don't think most legislators are really educated about food and agriculture. I don't think they ask the right questions. And I think the fact that the industrial food lobby is probably 400 or 500 times as bigger as the as big as the lobby for good food, we're going to have legislators who are making bad decisions.
Sad truth. I guess it kind of the opposite end of that spectrum, you know, in the absence of government and legislators that really want to make these changes, a question came in about personal choices in terms of a food system, a just food system, a healthy planet. Are there things outside of, you know, I mean, we talked a little bit about the plant-based diet, but what kind of things would you recommend to, you know, thoughtful individuals looking to kind of have an impact?
Well, thoughtful individuals looking to have an impact on their own diet, thoughtful individuals with money, it's not a big challenge. Thoughtful individuals who want to have an impact on the food system in general, can be supporting local and national movements for food sovereignty, can be supporting better school lunches, can be supporting land reform, can be supporting better labeling, can be supporting more transparency in agriculture, can be supporting regulating factory farm, including the factory farming of animals, including pesticide regulations, can be supporting existing Clean Water and Air Acts, Clean Water and Air regulations, and passing new ones. I mean, the list is, it's finite, but it's really long.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And do you think that individuals have any influence over, you know, you talked about this being an issue of supply. You know, consumers can obviously move the market, but for, you know, kind of fast food options and restaurants in our communities, do you think that there are ways that individuals can pursue public policy that makes options in communities healthier?
I mean, I had this conversation with a board member of McDonald's 10 years ago, 12 years ago, and he said, the company is well aware of the changes it needs to make, but it's like a steamship. It's very hard to turn it around, but we are turning it around. That was 10 years ago. Anyone who argues that McDonald's is healthier than it was 10 years ago is being misleading. So I don't have much hope for fast food changing. We need to change the system. We need to change our own eating habits, yes. We need to change food in our communities, in our localities. We need to change farming to the extent that it's possible, but we need to look at big time legislation, both short and long term, to make changes in the food system. We have an ethanol mandate, the renewable food standard, the renewable fuel standard, that makes it so that 40% of the corn in Iowa, our biggest corn growing state, is grown for ethanol. If that subsidy were ended tomorrow, that means that maybe 10 or 15% of the landmass in Iowa would either be growing corn that was looking for a market or would be looking for new things to plant. That's a big difference. What if we subsidized the growth of good food on that percentage of acreage in Iowa instead of subsidizing the growth of food for an inefficient fuel? That's an interesting question. It's not going to happen anytime soon, but it's a political question. It's not really a food question.
Yeah, and it seems like so much of this is political.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, eating is an agricultural act, and agriculture is determined by politics.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And do you think that it's a sort of a hot topic right now of kind of alternative meats, alternative milks, and, you know, do you think that there's a space for legislation there, or is it really, you know, focusing on sort of what comes out of our land first?
I think that this gets into a little bit a discussion of how change happens. And I have feelings about this. I'm not an expert on this. I think that the thing to do, this is a very, what's called a soft system. It's a very flexible, big, mysterious, hard to understand system, the food system. I think we need to make changes that are achievable and that make sense as quickly as we can. Those might mean limiting the sale of junk food to children. It might mean taxing sodas. It might mean the $15 minimum wage. It might mean improving the status in general of laborers in the food system. It might mean regulating pesticides better. It might mean regulating raising animals better, and so on down the list. The achievable, high impact, changes we can make are actually not that many. My feeling is we make some of those changes and we see what the impact is. And then we make decisions about what changes would be best to follow on those. We can't say, here's a 10-year plan, or we could say here's a 10-year plan, but even if there were a 10-year plan, we have to start with the 1-year plan, make those changes, and then reevaluate. So any change in the right direction, any movement in the right direction is welcome, but some things are going to be more effective than others, and we won't know until we start to make those kinds of changes.
Absolutely. I know we just have a couple minutes left, so I wanted to turn to a couple of questions that are more about your experience, your professional experience. So two questions. How has the focus of your career changed up till this point? And then what was your greatest discovery when researching to write this book?
Well, I was an anti-war activist and a community organizer when I was young. And when I started writing, I found myself writing recipes. I justified that as a noble task. I think it is a noble task, teaching people how to cook. Americans in general are so out of touch with cooking traditions. That's one of the reasons we accepted such a terrible diet in the 20th century, why it was so easy to market it to us. But around 2000, when I saw the opportunity to begin writing in a more broader sense, to begin writing about food in general and not just cooking and eating, I took that opportunity and worked my way into being an opinion columnist for the New York Times, and enjoyed that and thought that was meaningful. And then in 2015 decided I wanted to do something a little bit bigger and turned my attention to academia, which is how I wound up at Mailman, and to writing animal vegetable junk, which is what I've done. So that's kind of my career path. I think there was a lot that was revealed to me in the researching of this book. I think one was the real dominance of ultra-processed foods in the marketplace and how their availability really determines what people eat. The other is how the United States has pushed its way of agriculture and its way of eating on the rest of the world. And I think the third is the role of government in enforcing white power and white supremacy through agriculture from the time of the end of the Civil War right up until now. And I think, you know, obviously I've given short shrift to all of those topics, but in a tiny little nutshell, those were sort of the three most interesting things that I learned the most about in writing Animal Vegetable Junk.
Great. Well, this has been really informative. I know that we have a raffle coming up, but I just wanted to thank you for having this conversation with me. And we had so many questions in the chat that we couldn't get to, but it's great to see so much engagement. And I'm sure that everyone would benefit from kind of learning more about this space.
Well, I'd like to thank everyone. I know we had a lot of participants, a couple hundred, which is great. And I'd like to thank everybody for joining. And I guess that's it. But we have this very exciting raffle, which Christina is going to do.
We do. I'm not going to do it. Rebecca.
Do it. Here's Rebecca.
Thank you. Thanks.
With the Wheel of Fortune. Here's Vanna White.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. And Mark, thank you for celebrating the launch of your new book with us, and Christina for moderating questions. And thank you, everyone, for submitting such thoughtful questions. This has been really great. Mark has been very generous. And as they said, we're going to raffle off 2 signed copies of his book, and we will use a random name picker to select a few lucky winners. So I'm just going to share my screen and we will do that. Okay. So first winner. Risa Starr. All right, congratulations, Risa. We will get your address and send you a signed copy. And now we're gonna do one more. And congratulations, Celine Chan. So we will get your, we'll reach out and get your addresses so we can get you a signed copy of Mark's book. And again, thank you, Mark. And thank you everyone for joining this webinar today.
Yeah, and I will add in a thank you as well. Mark, that was a terrific presentation. First, a terrific 20 minutes or so on the book, but even more so, I mean, uncovering an incredible amount of history in a very short period of time. Christina, you did a great job of not just reading questions, but of really sort of picking, going through the questions. And I know how hard this is to do, going through the questions and seeing how questions fit together and what fits together and what doesn't fit together. And, you know, bunching together a bunch of questions and asking them to Mark. So congratulations and thank you for that. And Mark, you know, your responses to the questions, as always, were really thoughtful and interesting. And I think should lead people to want to go out and buy and read this book. I also loved and just thought it was fun, Becca, the raffle there at the end, and congratulations to Risa and Celine, our first raffle winners at least with that sort of round the clock Vegas style raffle, which I really liked and felt like watching. There is a question, where can we buy the book? Are there any small bookstores selling it? Mark, I'm sure it's on all the big bookstores, but if someone wanted to go to a small bookstore, is there a place that you know of?
There's also a website called bookshop.com that links you to your local independent. So that's a good way to buy the book if you want to try for a local, but you can also, obviously, I mean, my local bookstore is carrying it. Hopefully yours is also.
Great. And again, I just want to thank everybody for joining and thank Mark for sort of presenting. Congratulate Mark again on the publication of this really important and hopefully really influential book. And with that, I think I want to wish everybody a safe evening and a healthy day, healthy week, and just take care. And thanks all.
Thank you, Michael.